Hello everyone, my name is Liu Hongrui, coming from Gamma Lab, affiliated to Beijing University of Post and Telecommunications. Today is an honor for me to share with you our work, Confidence Matrix, Self-Training on Graph Neural Networks Under Distribution Shift. I will introduce my work from four aspects. Firstly, I will illustrate the self-training framework on graph neural networks and some of our studies on it. We know that GSNs have recently attracted many researchers' interest, most notably on semi-supervised node classification tasks. But their success typically hinges on careful training with large amounts of labeled data. It's very expensive and time-consuming to obtain such labels in reality. To this end, many semi-supervised and unsupervised methods are proposed, and self-training is one of such promising methods. The framework and objective function are respectively shown as follows. On the very beginning, we only have a labeled dataset, and thus we learn a teacher model with such an ERM objective function. Then, teacher model will predict unlabeled data using part of predictions as pseudo-labels. Together with labeled dataset, we learn a student model on the augmented dataset with a whole objective function. Please note that here we see part of instead of all of because predictions are not always correct, and the common practice is to filter the incorrect predictions by confidence, since high confidence often means high accuracy. However, from the perspective of information theory, high confidence means models have learned most of information contained in the labeled data. Then, if we add the same information to the dataset, will it really work? Or more specifically, are all the unlabeled nodes still labeled with high confidence truly useful? With the above question, we conduct a few empirical studies. Firstly, we first visualize the relationship between confidence and the information gain on Hongrui and Zhiqiang dataset, where the x-axis is the confidence, while the y-axis is the information gain, and the blue and orange dots respectively represent nodes with correct and incorrect predictions. We can observe a negative correlation, implying that existing graph self-training methods only focus on easy nodes, that's nodes with low information gain. Secondly, we realize the node embeddings of JSON on Hongrui and Zhiqiang. The darker dots represent a node to be an easy node. From the plots, we find that most of easy nodes are far from the decision boundary. They are low gain. However, these nodes are always emphasized by current self-training methods by force of high confidence. Therefore, we see they are cheated by confidence in this way. Once the self-training is treated by confidence, could something worse have happened? Yes. We randomly generate five blue nodes following a two-dimensional Gaussian distribution to represent labeled nodes in one class, and another 4,000 green nodes following the distribution of concentrated circles to represent labeled nodes belonging to other classes. It should be noted that a large amount of unlabeled nodes still exists in the dataset. But for clarity, we omit them in the figure. Clearly, we find that nodes far from the decision boundary are paid more attention, and thus the distribution shift pneumonia between the original and augmented dataset appears. Such a distribution shift could be understood as a data bias introduced by self-training. So next, we will propose our methods, DRGST, to handle the distribution shift. We assume the original labeled dataset follows the population distribution. Firstly, let's write the loss correction on the original labeled dataset. Then, the loss function under the distribution shift caused by self-training is as follows. The first term is for pseudo-labeled data, while the second term is for labeled data. we expect the distribution shift don't exist. In other words, we expect LST equal to LPOP. Luckily, we find that if there is an additional bit term gamma U in LST, LST would be equal to LPOP. The bit term gamma U is the ratio of the population distribution to the shifted distribution for node VU. Next, we need to calculate gamma U. However, we note that the population distribution PPOP in LST is generally intractable, which means that gamma U can't be accurately calculated. In order to solve this problem, we realized gamma U as follows. The darker area means the larger gamma U. We observe that gamma U becomes smaller when getting closer to the central area. Clearly, we find it's just the same change trend of the information gain. Therefore, we adopt the information gain to approximate gamma U. So, how to calculate such an important information gain? In fact, the information gain can be written as a difference between two terms. The first term could represent the information of the model parameters and the posterior. And the second term is the information of model parameters given an additional node VU. So by means of the difference, we could know the additional information brought by node VU. However, as a consensus, the posterior probability given J, P theta, is intractable in practice, and always computationally expensive. The common practice is to estimate using dropout variational inference. Due to our focus on the graph, we extended to dropage variational inference based on a previous study. The key idea for dropout or dropage variational inference is to calculate the probability vector t times at inference. Then, we could calculate the information gain as follows. With such an information gain for each node, after normalization, we could obtain the final loss function. So far, we have recovered the shifted distribution introduced by self-training via information gain. Is everything is okay? No. Let's recall the relationship between confidence and information gain shown before. Blue nodes are correct prediction, and orange nodes are incorrect. We can observe that suitables of hard nodes are more likely to be incorrect. Meanwhile, we note that our methods will also focus more on hard nodes. In other words, the impact of incorrect suitable nodes are enlarged during self-training. In order to remedy this defect, we propose to incorporate loss correction strategy into graph self-training to improve the quality of suitables. Loss correction has the following assumptions. Given a model F theta bar trained by suitables as well as a model F theta star trained by ground truth labels, we have a C multiplied by C dimension transition matrix, such that all the predictions of F theta bar could be represented by T multiplied by the corresponding prediction of F theta star. Here, each element Tij of the transition matrix represents the probability of class I misclassified into class J. Here, we make a contrast on the training pipeline without and with transition matrix. The difference is that we regard the output of the student model multiplied by a pre-computed transition matrix as F theta bar. After back replication on F theta bar, at inference, the output of the student model could be deemed as F theta star. The computation of transition matrix is shown before. And more details can be found in our paper. Finally, we got our novel self-training framework named as DRDST. Specifically, we first train a teacher model on the labeled dataset. Then we still label part of unlabeled nodes and calculate their information gain. Subsequently, we calculate the transition matrix, and finally train a student model. We repeat the procedure above until convergence. We also theoretically analyze the inference, the inference factor of self-training. Conclusion shows the performance of self-training is negatively related to the difference between the two distributions as well as the error rate of syllables. Exactly, both of factors are considered in our method. The rationality of our method is guaranteed. Okay, now we come to the experiments. We conduct experiments on five datasets, Coral, Salicier, PubMed, Coral 4, Flickr, with four label rate, 3, 5, 10, 20. We compare most of graph self-training methods, DRGSTDO and DE, respectively represent DRGST with dropout and drop age variational inference. We can find DRGST outperforms almost all the baselines by a considerable margin across most cases. Besides, we also realize the learned embeddings for unlabeled nodes and tested nodes. For the unlabeled nodes, we could find from the first three pictures that a more crisp decision boundary gradually appears during self-training. For test nodes, from the last three pictures, we could find the separability of different classes for test nodes is gradually improved. Finally, let me make a summation. As a whole, we have two discoveries. We find that not all the high confidence nodes are useful for graph self-training, and paying more attention to a high confidence node would introduce the distribution shift. To overcome such defects, we propose a novel graph self-training framework, DRGST, and theoretically prove its rationality. For the future work on graph self-training, I think one can start with serving these two challenges. One is how to crack the syllables, and another one is how to employ more effective metrics apart from confidence. That's all my introduction to our work. More questions, you could contact me via email. I also recommend you to subscribe to our official account. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have questions in chat. So if the authors are available, one question is, could you explain the information gain in more detail? Is there a formula that you, or like some intuition that you can provide?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Could I share my screen? I need the PPT. Okay, thank you.
You should be able to share your screen.
Can you see it?
Yes.
Okay. The information gain. Yes, here we see the information gain. Here the information gain is the information gain about model parameters. It's also known as the epistemic uncertainty. It's the difference between the two terms we can see here. The first one is the entropy, and the second one is the allotropic uncertainty. And we can see the first one means the information about of the model parameters and the posterior, and the second one is the information of model parameters given additional node view. And by calculating the difference between the two terms, we get the information gain. Here we can see during the calculation of the information gain about parameters about model parameters, we can see there is we need to calculate the expectation P theta given G. We know the P theta given G, in fact, is the posterior and often intractable in practice. And many methods calculated, estimated using the Bayes methods. But someone has proposed that the dropout variational inference can do it. And during our focus on the graph, we use the dropout variational inference. During the information gain estimation, the dropout variational inference is to we know that during training we often use the dropout layer to drop some features or model parameters. But at inference, we often set the dropout to be zero and scale the corresponding model parameters. But at the dropout variational inference, we don't set the dropout to be zero. That means we calculate the possibility with dropout at inference, and we calculate the t times the possibility. Then we can calculate the PUG to get the mean of the PUGT hat. We can see the above one is the expectation. Then we use it to calculate the entropy. And the second one, with it, we can calculate the information gain. The second one is the minus between the first terms and the second terms. I hope my answer could help you. Thank you.
Thank you. That was very useful.